Well, hey, good morning, church. We're so glad that you're joining us today. My name's Emily. I'm a worship leader here. We have an amazing service planned for you, and we wanted to start our day by worshiping our God. It says all across the Bible to sing your praises to the Lord, to worship his name. We believe that he is so worthy of all of our praise, all of our worship. So that's why we sing together. We want to teach you a new song this morning, and it's all about being in the midst of a battle. And maybe you can relate. Maybe you can say that this is what it feels like for me right now. It feels like that I'm in this battle. And we just want this song to be a reminder of who our God is, that even when we can only see the season that we're in, when we can only see the now, God can see the forever. When we can only see what's blocking us, what's ahead of us, the mountain that's in front of us, he can see the other side. So can we praise him for his faithfulness? We're gonna teach you this chorus.
isn't that an incredible thing that we get to praise our God for? That in the midst of the battle, in the midst of the trouble and the hurt, our God is present there with us. He is walking with us. He is fighting for us. So can we praise our God together? We sing.
With just one word, you calm the storm that surrounds me. With just one word, the darkness has to retreat.
Praise you, Jesus.
With just one touch, I feel presence of heaven. With just one touch, my eyes are open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. With just one word, you heal what's broken inside. Yes, you do, Lord. With just one word.
Something that
From the darkness, I called your name, and into darkness, your mercy came. You called me out, you lifted me up. How great is your love? You bore my weakness, you took my shame. You buried my burdens in fields of grace. You called me out, you lifted me up. How great is your love? Come on, let's sing this together. From the heights of heaven, you stepped down to earth. Innocent perfection, gave your life for us.
God, we thank you so much that not only are you a powerful, mighty God that can move the mountains in front of us, but God, you're a loving, caring God, that you see us in the midst of the battle. God, you help us through the battle. So God, we pause in this moment to just set our eyes on you, to cling to you as our hope and as our joy, as our strength. And God, today we give you all the glory, all the honor. God, we worship you alone together. We love you. It's in your mighty name that we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Well, hey, Crossroads Church, Eric Anderson here, and I have an exciting update for you. As you've heard recently, we are doing this incredible thing called Give Hope. This is a new initiative where we want to partner with a great organization to bring hope into the corners all around our world. And so we decided to partner with this great organization called Home of Hope in India. And it's an organization that is rescuing women from human trafficking and getting them reacclimated with their new lives, new identity, and their new reality. And so we decided as a church, the first Sunday of every month, that we are going to give away 10% of our offering that comes in on that weekend. And I got to tell you, you guys showed up and showed off how generous you were. In fact, we already raised $10,254 for this organization. They needed about $43,000, and you were already almost one quarter of the way there. So thank you, thank you, thank you for being so generous, as we're hoping to fund their entire ministry year for 2021. So thank you for showing up and showing off with your generosity. And I just gotta say, the reason we can partner with these organizations is because of you, because you are a generous church. And if you wanna give today, you can do so in a many different ways. You can go to cr.life and click the Give tab. You can go ahead and give through the app, or you can also mail your generosity to the address you see below. So again, thank you, thank you, thank you for being so generous and changing lives all around our community and this world. And for all of us as a church, we do have one announcement I want to give you as a heads up on, and it's actually something that's happening today. So, and it's for those of you who are new to church or maybe new to this church, in a space, it's a space and place called Starting Point. And so it's a place where you can actually get connected. You can hear more about the mission, vision, and values that we have as a church. And actually, you can actually attend in two different ways this weekend. It's happening today, October 11th, but you can attend either on Zoom or in person after the service today at each one of our campuses. But if you want to attend that, we just need to know, you head over to cr.life, click events to register, and we'd love to see you there. Now, for all of us now, we are here in this series at a crossroads, and Joelle Hassler is actually going to give us an incredible message about our decision-making when it comes to what do we do when it feels like we're really not getting anywhere fast. But before we hear from her, go ahead and take a look at this.
Well, hey everyone, it's so nice to be with you. My name's Joelle, and I wanna say a special hello to everyone who's watching live at the campuses right now. So glad that you made it to church today. And then of course, a special hello to everyone who's watching online, whether I'm in your kitchen or your living room or wherever. So glad that you tuned in today. I wanna start off this message by talking a little bit about treadmills. And yes, we have a treadmill on stage with me today because I just have a lot of questions about people who run on treadmills. I go into the gym and I see all these treadmills, they're lined up and people are on them and they're running. And I just wonder, why are you doing that? Why are you running in place going nowhere? And I'm wondering that because I've run other places, beautiful places where there are trails and where there's landscapes and buildings and people, all these kinds of things that keep your mind off of the fact that you're actually running, which is pretty much the worst thing in the world, I think. I've even been on those treadmills where they have the special screens that have paths, like videos of paths, so it looks like you're running through the mountains. But when you're on there, you know you're not in the mountain really, I think it's so frustrating to be moving and to be running and never go anyplace and never experience anything except just numbers ticking forward on a screen. I think it's pretty frustrating whenever in life you're moving, but nothing is changing. And maybe you've been feeling a little bit like that when it comes to your own life right now, like you're on a treadmill at this very moment. Like you've been moving towards the solution to a problem or a goal that you want to accomplish, and you're taking all kinds of steps, but nothing is happening at all. You wake up in the morning and you run at a really fast pace, and at the end of the day, you end up exactly where you started. Has that ever happened to you? Like you're putting effort in, but the dial's not turning at all, and the tides are not changing, and the wind is not shifting. And right now, your mantra for your life is, I'm moving, but nothing's changing. If this has ever happened to you or it's happening to you right now, then you know this is not fun. And it's especially not fun when other people in your life seem to have gotten off the treadmill and they're actually running through a beautiful mountain path and they're effortlessly making it to the mountain peak where there are breathtaking views and there's miraculously like a professional photographer there to take a beautiful picture that they can post to their Instagram page. Maybe you're laughing right now because you actually have a friend who posted a photo like that this week, and you were wondering, are the battles I'm facing right now ever going to end in that kind of victory? Or maybe you're not smiling or laughing right now because it's incredibly stressful and frustrating for you to watch other people succeed when you feel like you're floundering through life right now. But what if we could do something about this today? What if we could address this sense that I'm moving, but nothing's changing? What if over the next 20 minutes or so, we could shift our perspective just a little bit to give us some encouragement and hope? And what if there was just one simple next step that we could all take to get us out of the funk that we're in right now? Well, I think actually all of that is possible today because of the passage of scripture that we're going to be reading together out of Joshua chapter 6. God's people, the Israelites, they're focusing on and they're in the middle of a moment of their life where it feels like they're moving, but nothing's changing. They have been taking steps forward in obedience and faith, doing what God has asked them to do, but it feels like he's not moving right now and they're stuck. And many of us are in that stuck place of life right now. So I want to dive into Joshua 6, but before we do, I'd like to pray because I just want to ask God to speak to us through his word today and help our perspective change a little bit. So let's pray together. God, first, we're just thankful to be here and to have the next 20 minutes or so to think about you and what you might be doing in our life. And I know some people who are watching or listening right now are facing giant, insurmountable challenges in their life right now. Others have nagging, persistent problems that they're facing. Some of them are facing or about to face a problem that hasn't surfaced yet. And we are all going to need you to face those. So would you help us in the next few minutes to shift our perspective and to be courageous enough to take a next step that you might prompt us to take? We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. All right, thanks for praying with me. Let's dive into Joshua chapter 6. If you have a Bible or a Bible app, now's a great time to turn there. I'll also put the verses on the screen over here in just a minute. But let me tell you what's happening in Joshua 6. God's people, the Israelites, they have been following after God, but they have had a rocky history. In fact, if we had an Israelite standing right here, right now, and we read them their own story, they would probably not believe it. They'd be like, there's no way all of that happened to my people. Because they were enslaved for 400 years, and then God miraculously rescued them out of slavery. But then they wandered in the desert for 40 years, and they had no food except this food called manna that fell from the sky every day so that they could eat. And now God has told their leader, Joshua, that they can go into this land, this promised land, where they can grow their own food and grow their families and be a flourishing people group. And they've crossed over this very important Jordan River in order to get into the promised land. But when they go to the promised land and they arrive there on the other side of the river, it's inhabited. There's already people there living there. It's kind of like they've had to go to the bathroom for decades. And they finally found a porta potty and they ran up to the door and the darn sign is red. Occupied. And they have to hold it a little bit longer. That's what this frustrating moment is like for the Israelites. So I want to dive right in to chapter 6, verse 1, and see what happens. Let's read this together. Now the gates of Jericho were tightly shut because the people were afraid of the Israelites. No one is allowed to go out or in. But the Lord said to Joshua, I have given you Jericho, its king, and all its strong warriors. You and your fighting men should march around the town once a day for 6 days. 7 priests will walk ahead of the ark, each carrying a ram's horn. On the 7th day, you're to march around the town 7 times with the priests blowing the horns. And when you hear the priests give one long blast on the ram's horns, have all the people shout as loud as they can, and then the walls of the town will collapse and the people can charge straight into the town. All right, they're facing the Battle of Jericho. There is this town called Jericho. It's inhabited, and God is addressing the issue right before them that it's inhabited, and they need to go in and get the inhabitants out. And God gives them this astounding promise in verse 2. I really want us to pay attention to it, so let me read it for you again. But the Lord said to Joshua, I have given you Jericho, its king, and all its strong warriors. Now pay attention to the tense of this promise. It's past tense. God is saying, I've already given you the victory. You've already won the Battle of Jericho. And that is a promise that the Israelites can cling to. It is a firm promise for them. But then God goes into giving Joshua all these instructions of what they have to do in order to take hold of this promise. And the instructions that he gives them are certifiably insane. Look at this. He says, first of all, you have to march around the town of Jericho once a day for 6 days. Then he says, on the 7th day, you're to march around the town 7 times. And then after that, they're supposed to yell really loud. and then the people can charge straight into the town after the walls collapse. Why do I think these instructions are insane? I probably don't even need to explain, do I? But there's a few really good reasons. First is, marching around doesn't weaken wall foundations as far as we know. I think we could circle something for hundreds of years and it would not just collapse because of that. I'm not sure shouting really helps either. Also, this wall is massive. The wall around Jericho, scholars think, was roughly 12 to 15 feet high, about 5 to 6 feet deep. It's solid stones. There's one entrance, and behind that entrance, there are some fierce warriors. The people of Jericho were known to be really strong warriors. This is a scary wall. And then lastly, these people are going to look totally ridiculous doing this. In the history of all wars, no one has ever said, all we're going to do is march around and shout. So it's possible they're going to get made fun of in this moment because they're doing this absurd thing that God is asking them to do. So do they do it? Do they go ahead and follow what God is asking them to do through Joshua? Well, maybe you already know the answer, but let's read it together. After Joshua spoke to the people, the 7 priests with the ram's horns started marching in the presence of the Lord, blowing the horns as they marched, and the ark of the Lord's covenant followed behind them. Some of the armed men marched in front of the priests with the horns and some behind the ark with the priests continually blowing the horns. Do not shout, do not even talk, Joshua commanded, not a single word from any of you until I tell you to shout, and then you can shout. Now, this is amazing because seemingly without hesitation, they go for it and they begin doing the absurd thing that God asked them to do. And that makes me want to just take a pause in this message, just a little time out for a minute to ask you this question. When it comes to the Jericho that you're facing in your life right now, the problem that you're facing that's maybe massive or maybe it's small but nagging, and maybe you've been moving towards trying to solve the problem, but nothing's been happening. When it comes to that Jericho wall in your life, would you be willing to do something totally absurd if God asked you to, and if you knew the outcome was going to be that your problem would be eliminated? Would you be willing to circle your problem instead of attack your problem? Would you be willing to maybe get on your knees and confess sin in your life and then just wait for God to act on your behalf? Would you be willing to do something totally absurd if God asked you to? And I'm asking you that question because I think most of us would answer no to that question. I think most of us are willing to follow God as long as it makes sense. We're willing to follow God as long as we're mostly in control. We're willing to follow God as long as he doesn't ask us to do something that would cause our family and our friends to think that we are crazy. I think most of our natural answer to that question, would you do something absurd, is just, no, I wouldn't do anything absurd that God asked me to do. But maybe you're in a different place today. Maybe you would be willing to do something absurd because the problem that you've been facing or the goal that you've been trying to accomplish, you've done everything that you have in your power to do and nothing is changing. And you know you need God to intervene. Or maybe it's that the problem is so big, so seemingly insurmountable, that you know that you're going to need God's help in order to overcome it. And so you're willing to do something absurd. I think that's actually where the Israelites were at in this very moment with the Battle of Jericho. They were looking at that wall and they knew they were going to need God's supernatural help if they were going to go through it or over it. And so they were willing to march. They were willing to do what God asked them to do. And this was probably the wackiest game of follow the leader that has ever been played in the history of that game. And if we were playing this game of follow the leader, we'd probably at least ask some questions. Maybe a question like this: how far is it around this wall that we're gonna be marching around day after day? And why can't we talk? Why can't we say anything? And do we all have to go every single day? And is there a Starbucks coming up? That's probably the question that I would ask. All of these questions right here, the Israelites did not ask. Instead, they just did what God asked them to do. And then they saw the promise fulfilled. And I want to read that together. On the seventh day, the Israelites got up at dawn and marched around the town as they had done before. But this time they went around the town seven times. The seventh time around, as the priests sounded the long blast on their horns, Joshua commanded the people, "Shout, for the Lord has given you the town." And let's jump down to verse 20. When the people heard the sound of the ram's horns, they shouted as loud as they could. Suddenly, the walls of Jericho collapsed, and the Israelites charged straight into the town and captured it. They did what he said to do, and they marched one step in front of the other in obedience to the God that they had seen do miraculous things before and whom they were sure would do a miraculous thing for them again. In faith, they marched, and God did what he said he was going to do. He was keeping his promises. He was providing for his people. He was tearing down the wall. He was doing the impossible. And all of this is astounding. All of this is so cool. All of this is so faith-building for them, for the Israelites. But I think if we're honest, when we're reading a story from 1400 BC that's found in the Old Testament, it's hard for us to feel the impact of that story. It's hard for us to be moved into action. It's hard for us because we are wondering the answer to this question. Why do the walls of Jericho crashing down matter to me? And I'm wondering, maybe the walls actually crashing down don't matter that much to us today. Because maybe some of us have never seen a miracle like that, and maybe we're not anticipating that we'll see that kind of miracle in our lifetime. But maybe God knew that we were going to be studying Joshua 6 today in the year 2020, and maybe he wanted us to focus on something else today other than those walls falling down. Maybe instead he wants us to focus on what the Israelites did with his promise. When they were circling, when they were marching day after day after day, what were they thinking about? What was their perspective? Maybe that's what we need to be focusing in on from this passage today, because the truth is we're all circling something right now. We all have a Jericho wall and we're marching around. Some of us haven't seen any movement at all. And we're wondering as we're moving if the walls are weakening or if we're just weakening. And we're having a hard time seeing God's promises for us or if he's even made any promises to us at all. And if that's how you're feeling right now at this very moment, you're definitely not alone. And I think I might be able to give you a why to why you're feeling like that right now. And here's what it is. I think we're focusing on our problem more than we're focusing on God's promises and all the grace here right now, you guys, in this moment, because it is really tough when you wake up in the morning and your wall is staring you in the face again. And maybe today you woke up and you thought, my parents are still not talking to me. And I didn't get the job and I'm still not pregnant. And the pounds are still hanging on. And the thoughts in my head are still weighing me down and I don't know what to do. And if that's you in this moment, then what we have to do is we need to shift our perspective the way the Israelites did. We need to shift my perspective from my problem to God's promises. And this is not just a cool statement that I learned in some wordsmithing class in seminary. They actually didn't even have a class like that when I went to seminary. The reason I'm saying this to you today is because I believe this might actually help us when we're facing Jericho walls in our lives today or in the future. Because the truth is that the walls we're facing, they're lying to us, you guys. They're telling us lies every day. They're telling us we're not good enough, that we're not strong enough to go through or over them, that we're weak and hopeless and stuck, that we've failed before and we're gonna fail again. Those walls are lying to us. But God has truth to tell us through his promises if we can shift our perspective to those truths. Truths like the fact that God is for us and never against us. In Romans, Paul writes, if God is for us, who can ever be against us? Or the truth that our last chapter of our life doesn't have to be our next chapter. Look what 2 Corinthians says. This means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone and a new life has begun. Or the truth that no matter what it is that we're facing, we can get through it with the help of Jesus. Look at what it says in Philippians. Paul writes, I know how to live on almost nothing or with everything. I've learned the secret of living in every situation, whether it's with a full stomach or empty, with plenty or little, for I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength. And there's so many more promises like that in the Bible that we can cling to and that we can rely on and that we can focus on instead of the problems that we're facing right now. And maybe right now you're thinking, that sounds pretty good, Joelle. I'd love to get my eyes off of the lying problem and onto God's promises. But how do I do that? What's a practical next step that I could take to shift my perspective? Well, I think we should do exactly what the Israelites did, and this is what they did. They took an absurd leap of faith. In the book of Hebrews in the New Testament, this is what it says about those people. It says, it was by faith that the people of Israel marched around Jericho for 7 days, and the walls came crashing down. This might seem like a very simple sentence, but it's saying a whole lot. Because those Israelites were marching, they took one foot and put it in front of the other because of their faith in God. On day 6, they kept going. On day 7, lap 7, they kept going because they had faith that God would come through for them. And they were willing to do anything absurd that he asked them to do because they knew God was the one fighting their battles. And that leads me to a question for every single one of us for today, for this moment. And that's just, would you be willing to do something absurd that God is asking you to do in faith so that you can shift your perspective from the problem to his promise? Because I have to be honest that the things that Christ followers do, the things that Christians do in order to increase our faith and help us focus on God's truth, they're all a little bit crazy, the things that we do. They're a little bit absurd. Let me just give you a list. Sometimes we pray and we talk to a God that we can't see so that we can keep the lines of communication open with him so we can hear what he might be asking us to do. Sometimes we wait and we don't do anything to tackle the problem in front of us, just expecting God to move on our behalf. Sometimes we fast, we eliminate things from our life so that we can focus more fully on God for a day or a few days at a time. Sometimes we memorize scripture, we memorize verses from the Bible so that when we're facing a problem, those things come into our mind and remind us of God's promises. And sometimes we confess sin. Sometimes we do get on our knees and say we're sorry so that nothing is in the way of us hearing from God. So as you look at this list, I just want to ask you, when it comes to your Jericho wall today, is there the one of these absurd things that you could do to say to God, I know you're there, and I know you're fighting my battle for me. I can't see the walls crumbling, but I want to believe that you're there. Because right now, I know there are so many of you who are circling right now. You have been marching and you're tired. And maybe you're confused or frustrated and it's day 6 and you want to give up. And I want to encourage you. Don't give up on day 6 when what God has for you on day 7, lap 7, is totally incredible and mind-blowing. Don't throw in the towel. Don't lay down. Don't walk away. Stay in the battle, doing something absurd to get your mind focused away from the problem and onto God's promises, because the truth is, he is fighting this battle for you. And the walls are weakening, even when you can't see it. He is there. You remember this treadmill that I talked about at the beginning of the message? I was sort of making fun of people who run on treadmills, and I'm sorry for that. But my point was that, you know, it's like you're moving and you're working really hard, but you're going nowhere when you're on a treadmill. But if you're a treadmill runner, you know that's not true, is it? When you're on a treadmill, you're gaining endurance, you're getting faster, you're getting stronger, you're getting healthier. It might seem absurd to run on a treadmill, but it's actually awesome for you. And the same is true when it comes to your faith. When you take an absurd leap of faith by praying or fasting or memorizing some scripture, it seems crazy, but it's awesome for you. And it will build your faith, and it will help you shift your perspective away from that lying problem that you're facing and onto the truth of God's promises. And we're going to close our service today by singing a song that reminds us of those truths. And then we'll be back just for one more thing at the end. But let me pray for you as we head into this song. Let's pray. God, I thank you that you have not left us alone in any battle that we're facing. I thank you that you are marching with us, that you have a plan and a purpose for us, that you love us so much, that you've called us your people. And I thank you, God, that you have offered for us opportunities to do absurd things so that we can give over control to you and express our faith in you. And I pray, God, for the people who are listening to this message today, that you would help them to shift their perspective and to try something absurd. And God, that they would see the walls come crashing down in their lives this week. We love you. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Come on, church. Can we declare this together? Can we sing this out?
And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, you see the beauty. When all I see is the cross, God, you see the empty tomb. Yes, we see.
What an incredible reminder that the battle belongs to God. So if you're circling right now, if you're marching, and it feels like the walls are not weakening at all, you've got to remember that God is with you in the battle and that the battle belongs to Him. And if you're feeling like you've been battling this Jericho wall all by yourself, we do not want you to feel like that. So we have set up a really simple email address so you can email us and let us know about the Jericho wall that you're facing in your life right now so we can come alongside you in that. And it's just simply myjericho@crossroads.co. We want to be able to remind you and to come together to remember that the battle belongs to God. Thanks for being with us today. It's been so fun. We hope to see you back here live in person or online for the final week of our At a Crossroads message series. Until then, we hope you have a great week. Bye, you guys.